Let's do mass Gaussian. And this is the last paper that we are going to cover for two-stage detectors. And then we are going to go into one-stage detectors later on, either this session or next session. With object detection, what you were doing was classify individual objects and at the same time localize them using a bounding box. We also saw semantic segmentation, and that was you were classifying each pixel into its corresponding category. With mask RCNN, you can combine the two. And that's going to be called instance segmentation. Let's see an example. This is an image. If you want to do object detection, then it's going to put bounding boxes around your objects, and that's all. If you want to do semantic segmentation, it's going to classify this pixel on this person and one pixel on the other person at this as the same class. It's a person, regardless. With instance segmentation, yes, this is a person, that's a person, but that's a different person. And that's what you want to do. These are all people. This is a different person compared to the other one and this one. There is also one behind them, etc. And they could be overlapping over each other. So that's not an easy task. So how are we going to approach it and what are the difficulties? You might say, okay, we solved the bounding box problem. So we're going to push it through our network. We're going to have a region of interest. We are going to do our pooling. And then we can do our classification and bounding box prediction. And then you might say, I'm going to add a bunch of other layers to do semantic segmentation per each box. Okay, that's the big picture. But what are the details and what are the difficulties? You're saying that you're going to put a multitask loss on each one of these sampled regions of interest. Actually, your region of interest is here. And you're going to have a multitask loss. We know how to handle the classification. That's going to be faster RCNN and the bounding boxes. So we solve this problem. Now, what is the loss of the mask? You're going to have a mask branch, and it's going to output a K by M squared dimensional output. So what is K? K is the number of classes, person, cat, dog, background, etc. So that's your classes. And then you're going to output a mask of M by M resolution. And that's where you're getting your K times M times M. So that's going to be your K M squared dimensional vector. Now, what is the task? What is L mask? You're going to use a per pixel sigmoid. So in that box that you have here, on per each pixel, you have m squared of m. Object K either exists or it doesn't exist. So these are independent tasks. If object K exists, it's not going to decrease or increase the probability of another object existing or not existing. So these are binary classification. That's why you have a sigmoid. It's not a softmax. And then once you do that, you're going to get the average binary cross entropy loss for the mask. But there is still another catch. During training, you don't want the objects that don't exist in your box to have any impact on your parameters through their gradients. That's why you're going to only look at your region of interest, the corresponding ground truth class. It's K, it's small k, it's not a capital K. And then your L mask had K m squared outputs. So you're only looking at m squared of them. And then you're going to include that in your loss. The other capital K minus one classes are not going to contribute to L mask. And because they are zero in your loss, their gradients are going to be zero. And therefore, they're not going to adjust your parameter. During training, only the boxes that exist are going to have an impact. But during inference, for each pixel, you're going to pick, you still need all of these. You still need to predict all of them. But then for each pixel, you're going to pick the maximum sigmoid value. And then you can also use CRF, etc., to make your predictions better. But there's a difference between how you train and how you do your prediction. That's why you need K times M squared outputs for your mask branch. And because it is individual, your network is going to have a much easier task solving independent problems rather than one complicated problem that is intertwined. So any questions about this? So the idea is we know how to solve our classification problem. We know how to put bounding boxes, and now we know how to do our segmentation per each bounding box. So I highly encourage you to just Google this paper and watch some nice videos on YouTube about what it can do, this method. But for now, we still have another difficulty. Previously, we were doing ROI pooling here. You had this box on your original image, then you would find the corresponding pixel or the corresponding pixels on your feature map after all of your convolutions are done. And then you find the top left corner, top right corner, etc. And then you draw your box, and it's going to be aligning with the features, with the pixels on your feature map, on your convolutional feature map in the end. So this is not a precise location. There is some quantization going on. This one has the precise location for the box, but once you project it into your feature map, you want these sides to be aligning with your pixels and to respect the resolution at that feature map. So you're doing some quantization, and that quantization is deadly for this algorithm because you want to exactly know where this box is, where this particular instance is, and then try to segment it. It wasn't that deadly for classification or boxes because all you needed to was a box, but now you need your pixels to be accurate. So you need to have accuracy at the level of pixels. So how do you take care of it? You don't quantize. The idea is that don't quantize. Let X be the continuous coordinate for this box. But how are we gonna achieve it? X is actually the coordinate of these boxes over there. But then when you were projecting it, you were doing some quantization. Let's say your resolution from your original image to the feature map dropped by 16. Then you would need to turn that into an integer, and that's gonna be your quantization. So you are missing some of your floating point, and your box is not in the exact location that it needs to be. That is ROI pooling. So the idea is that you need to avoid any quantization for the ROI boundaries and the boundaries of your bins. So what is ROI align doing then? You start with X, and then you find these locations of your bins. Now you have a bunch of bins. Per each bin, you're gonna sample 4 points. So per each bin, you sample 4 points. Then you're gonna, on those points, you're gonna do bilinear interpolation. And we learned about bilinear interpolation in spatial transformer network. So you're gonna do a bilinear interpolation, and then you're gonna know the exact pixel values. But in the end, per each bin, you need a single number. So what you do is you aggregate the results. You either find the maximum per each bin or you average. So now you are not sacrificing the location of these bounding boxes. So is everything clear? Any questions? So we had two problems to solve. One was, what is the loss of your mask? And how do you solve the problem that these locations are not accurate? Your boxes are not accurate enough for a segmentation task. They are accurate for a bounding box prediction task, but they are not accurate locations for a segmentation task. And that's how you solve both of the problems. You know what is the loss of your mask. Now you know that you need to replace your ROI pooling with another operation. You can call it ROI align. And now you solve both of the problems. In terms of the details, we can have two versions of the algorithm depending on what backbone structure you're gonna use for your underlying network. If it's ResNet or if it is feature pyramid network, the previous paper. And then all you do is the first part is the same as before. So this gray box is the same as before. What you do is you add the mask branch, and then you're predicting 80 classes. And this 14 by 14 is the actual resolution, is M that you see here, per each box, per each region of interest. So here are some qualitative results. These are different people, and they're colored differently. These are different bottles. They're colored differently and detected correctly. And then that's a table. The backpack, different people, different umbrellas, different people, different animals, different bottles, etc. So you can apply this method to yet another application by reframing the problem and that's human pose estimation. Human pose estimation is important for multiple applications. One of them is video games. So you want to know what are the key points in one person's body, and then you can translate the movement of that person. There's a camera, it could be the video cam of your computer, that's translating the actual locations of these key points, left shoulder, right elbow, etc., and translating them to an animated object inside your gaming environment. So you jump up and down on in front of your webcam, and then it's going to be translated into actions of your animated version. It could be another application, it could be in the movie industry. And we know that Hollywood is a massive market. Okay, gaming is also a massive market, probably as big as Hollywood, or perhaps bigger. So what modifications do you need to make to mask our CNN? What is going to be your mask now? The mask is, you're going to have a one-hot mask. It's going to be one at only, let's say, the right shoulder. That's your mask. And then it's going to be zero all over the body. So that's a one-hot mask. It's one on the knee and then zero everywhere else. And then you're going to have K masks. And these are going to correspond to the key point locations on our body. That's one modification. So you change your labeling. You change how you're coming up with your one-hot masks. The other change that you need to make is with Mask RCNN, you needed K binary masks. Now you're going to have, this was a binary problem. Now you're going to change that. You're going to change the sigmoid to a softmax, and then it's going to give you the K masks. So there is going to be competition between left shoulder and right shoulder in your loss function now. And this is going to be per each bounding box. You're predicting all of the K classes. Any questions about this?
I think it's clear.
Okay, perfect. I think we are out of time. For those of you who want to stay and ask questions, you can stay and ask. The ones who want to leave, you can leave. Next session, we are going to move to one-stage detectors.